In mid-2025, Christian Simpson, well known as the host of the YouTube channel Perifractic's Retro Recipes, surprised us with an unexpected announcement: his intention to acquire the Commodore brand. Over the years, the brand has passed through many different hands, and none of them have managed to restore it to the place it truly deserves. During this time, many Commodore fans have created peripherals and components, some of them of such high quality that they genuinely deserve to carry the Commodore name. Christian's goal is to bring these products under the official brand and perhaps, and this is my hope, to create entirely new products that once again make Commodore synonymous with quality. Building on this vision and using a variant of the Ultimate64 Elite-II motherboard as its foundation, an FPGA-based recreation of the original Commodore 64 hardware, the renewed owners of Commodore now present us with a new machine, the Commodore 64 Ultimate. The first production batch of the Commodore 64 Ultimate is already being shipped, and the first reviews of this new version of our beloved Commodore 64 are starting to appear. Mine has arrived, and now it's time for me to share my most honest opinion about this computer. The first thing we find inside the package is an elongated box, shaped like the early European versions of the Commodore 64. But featuring the artwork of the North American release. Where the original packaging proudly highlighted 64 kilobytes of memory, this new version now emphasizes 128 megabytes instead. When we open the box, the first thing we are greeted with is a warm welcome message, followed by stickers, an HDMI cable, a power supply, and a charming USB flash drive shaped like a cassette tape. Truly adorable. Beneath the Commodore 64 Ultimate, we find a manual that feels instantly familiar, very similar to the original one. It even includes basic examples closely resembling those from the classic manual. Programs to display a sprite on screen, generate sound, and work with character maps. I love it. And finally, the computer itself. I absolutely love the orange function keys, just like those found on the earliest Commodore 64 models. It was a great choice, as they clearly set it apart from the gray function keys seen on most Commodore 64 units of this type. The keys feel different from those of an original Commodore 64. They have a much more modern response when pressed, and overall the typing feel is very pleasant. The shift lock key does not physically stay pressed as it does on the original computer, but it is fully functional and behaves like a PC caps lock key. The texture of both the case and the keys is also different from that of the original Commodore 64. On the original machine, the keys are completely smooth, and while the case does have some texture, it is far less pronounced than on this new model. That said, I have to admit I really like this touch. The keys feel very pleasant, and it gives this model a new sense of personality. Let's continue with a first look at the computer itself. On the rear, just like on the original computer, we find the cartridge port, stereo audio jack, video audio output, serial port, cassette connector, and where the user port once was, it has now been replaced by an HDMI output Ethernet and two USB ports. And on the side, we find the DB9 ports for joysticks, a multifunction button, and the power input. As a small detail, unlike the function keys, the rear of the unit features port labels just as they appear on the later versions of this case design. On the earliest models, there were no labels on the ports at all. By pressing the multifunction button upward once, the Commodore 64 Ultimate powers on, and by pressing it again at any time, we can access the configuration menu. The configuration menu is very comprehensive, allowing us to adjust virtually every parameter of the Commodore's behavior. From the menu, we can browse our storage devices, search for new software, configure the Commodore 64's memory, set the CPU speed, or configure networking options. The Commodore 64 Ultimate features both an Ethernet network interface and built-in Wi-Fi. I'm not going to go into too much detail about the menu options in this video, as it would make it far too long. The only negative point I find with the menu is that it can sometimes be a bit confusing. When you make certain configuration changes, they are not applied immediately. Instead, the changes only take effect once you exit the submenu. You can change the color settings or disable the network, and see no immediate response until you leave the menu. It can be confusing, and I hope this will be addressed in future updates. In addition to being able to configure virtually every aspect of the Commodore 64's hardware, the system also offers the ability to enable some very interesting services, such as connecting to the Commodore through a web browser, using Telnet, transferring files via FTP, or even streaming audio and video directly from the Commodore 64 with very low latency into OBS, allowing us to share our gameplay live. One of the best things about this new Commodore is that we can continue to enjoy original peripherals. I've had no issues using Atari standard DB9 joysticks, and I've also tested original Sega gamepads, all of which worked without any problems. However, the 8-bit dual wireless controller, compatible with the Sega Mega Drive, did not work. It would be great to see support added for this type of peripheral in the future. In my opinion, one downside is that, at the time of recording this video, despite having two USB ports, you can't use gamepads through them, they are limited exclusively to connecting storage devices. It would be fantastic to support modern controllers, or even to emulate a Commodore 1351 mouse using a modern USB mouse. But for now, you'll need to rely on the same adapters you would use with an original Commodore 64. It's a real joy to be able to connect a Commodore 1530 dataset and load your old programs from tape. The colorful loading lines are back. By default, the Commodore 64 Ultimate plays the audio signal coming from the cassette port through its internal speaker. This can be a bit annoying, as on the original Commodore 64, this sound was not audible, which was something many appreciated. Fortunately, the Commodore 64 Ultimate can be configured so that this audio is no longer played through the internal speaker. Disk drives will work without any issues as well. By disabling the internal drive, we can connect the Commodore 1541 and use it as drive 8, loading all of our programs from disk. Of course, the internal drive, thanks to its FPGA-based simulation, can also load disk images flawlessly, including those that are copy-protected or use special tracks or sectors. Perhaps the peripherals I've had the most trouble with are cartridges. Ever since I owned my first Commodore 64 as a child, I've had the habit of always keeping my final cartridge 3 connected. I love its fast disk loading. I'm used to using its function keys to load directories or programs. I can reset the system with a single button press, and I can quickly inspect programs using its built-in monitor. On the Ultimate, this cartridge behaves somewhat inconsistently. I haven't been able to get it working reliably. Sometimes the function keys don't respond, or the desktop simply doesn't appear when I power on the Commodore. Kung Fu Flash is the other cartridge that has become absolutely essential for me. I haven't tested version 2 yet, but with version 1 it doesn't start correctly on the first attempt. By default, Kung Fu Flash automatically loads the last program that was used, but when powering on the Ultimate, it freezes. I then have to re-enter the Kung Fu Flash menu to unlock it. This can be a bit annoying, but I don't consider it a serious issue. I'm fairly certain this is something I haven't configured correctly on my Ultimate, even though I've tried changing nearly every possible option related to this behavior. If this has also happened to you and you've managed to fix it, feel free to share your solution in the comments. It's also possible to expand the Ultimate's audio capabilities by installing up to 2 SID chips. I tried installing a SWIN SID, and it didn't work correctly. That said, I believe the sound capabilities that already come with the Ultimate are more than sufficient, and while the SID simulation could still be improved, it is already quite good. If there's one thing that truly makes the Commodore 64 special, it's its vast and still growing software library. Even today in 2026, high-quality software continues to be developed for this system. A perfect example is Jupiter Fracture, which is included with the purchase of the Ultimate. As you can hear, by taking advantage of the Ultimate's additional capabilities, the sound is in stereo. The soundtrack is excellent and it's a very enjoyable game, capturing that classic simplicity of games from the past. Something I truly love. Before making this video, I tested a large amount of software on the Ultimate, and I have to say that overall the experience has been very good. The demos I've tried have run flawlessly without any noticeable issues. I should also mention that almost all of the demos I tested were specifically designed for the ASID 8580 chip, whose implementation in the Ultimate is excellent. On the other hand, when it comes to software designed for the ASID 6581, the implementation is not quite as perfect, and in some cases the sound is not exactly the same. That said, it's also true that not all ASID 6581 chips sound identical to begin with. The VIC chip is very well implemented, producing an image that is extremely close to that of a real Commodore 64, with a color palette that is almost identical. The difference becomes immediately apparent when compared to the implementation on Mister, where the colors appear too bright and less faithful to those of the original Commodore 64. The Commodore 64 Ultimate is, without a doubt, the definitive recreation of the original Commodore 64, and I truly hope it marks the beginning of a productive second life for the Commodore brand. I don't think we should see this computer simply as an attempt to manufacture the Commodore 64 once again, but rather as a reboot. I find Christian Simpson's decision to acquire Commodore and use the brand to officially support all those excellent products that already existed rather than letting the brand fade into obscurity, a very commendable idea. For now, there are no major innovations. Essentially, we have an Ultimate64 Elite 2 board inside a case bearing the legitimate Commodore name. Still, I hope this is only the beginning of a bright future for the Commodore brand, one that means so much to many of us. Can I recommend this product? That really depends on what you're looking for. If your only goal is to play the games from your childhood in the most faithful way possible, I wouldn't recommend a product at such a high price. If all you want is to plug in a joystick and play, you can achieve that for far less money using something like a Mister setup, or even for free through emulation. Although the experience in that case is entirely different. Without a doubt, this is a niche product. Only the most devoted fans of the original Commodore 64 will truly find meaningful advantages in something like this. It is a product that sells nostalgia, but one with a potentially bright future, thanks to a community that remains very active. I sincerely hope the new owners place the Commodore brand back where it truly belongs. Thank you very much for watching all the way to the end. I hope you enjoyed this review and I look forward to reading your comments below. Don't forget to subscribe and give the video a like to support the channel. See you soon!